Okay, so quickly, a little bit of recapitulation of the previous class. So we saw that with analogy, with in bringing analogy with the electromagnetic part, because it was already by then established that light has dual form. So just in the same way as Einstein tried to interpret the waveform of the particle form of light, in the same way Born was trying to interpret the wave nature of matter, moving particle. Okay, so since mod E square gives the intensity of radiation, it was interpreted that mod chi square should play a similar role. Okay, since the wave functions look so similar to each other because it was taken in that way. So thus the role of mod chi square should be similar to the role of mod E square, which is from where we get Born interpretation. In plain and simple language, Born interpretation is basically gives us the probability of finding a particle within a given interval in space at a given time. Okay, and as I told you that we have moved from deterministic to probabilistic. So because of Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, now you cannot point out and say, okay, so the particle is resting at x equal to from the origin, for example, if you take units from the origin, you cannot point out and say that the particle is existing at x equal to 2, if we are considering motion only along the x direction, for example. We cannot say that, because the moment I say the particle exists at x equal to 2 units, it means that I know its position, which means that delta x is 0, and delta x is 0 means delta px is infinite. So if I know the position, I don't know anything about the momentum. So if I am talking about a moving particle and I don't know anything about the momentum, then what am I talking about? Understood? So now the entire discussion switches from deterministic to probabilistic. All right, so this was Born's interpretation in his original language. I read it out in my last class, so I won't do it now. Just remember that this wave that we are trying to associate with the particle, just remember one thing, that at your stage, for example, when I was introduced to quantum mechanics and I was told in class that, okay, so there is this wave that for each moving particle, there is also associated a wave. And we cannot see it for large macroscopic objects, but for electrons and subatomic particles, this wave can actually be seen. So I'll be very frank with you, as a student, as an undergraduate student, my actual visualization was, okay, so this particle is moving and with it there is a wave moving, just like there are water waves, ripples in a pond. So similarly, when an electron is moving in an accelerator, there must be a wave, a halo kind of a thing, a halo that we see in pictures of gods and goddesses. So when an electron is moving, there is this halo kind of a thing, a wave that is moving, which is absolutely not the case. Okay, so it's not a kind of a guiding wave that will guide the particle. The particle will move like a particle, following a certain trajectory. But the point is that when the particle is moving under conditions where its wave nature, so it's a dual nature, just like when light is emanated from a source, it's not like photons are moving around like confetti. You know, confetti in birthday parties, when you burst a balloon and confetti spread all around. It's not like when light is coming out from a source, the photon particles spread out like confetti. It's not like that. It is when light interacts with matter that the packet of energy nature of light that is coming to the forefront. It is that behavior that takes the lead role. So you cannot mathematically, when you are mathematically trying to analyze the situation, the wave function nature of light will no longer give you the results that will match with the observation, but the discrete particle nature of light, if you take that into your mathematical analysis, that will give you results which will match with your observation. Similarly, in this case, when an electron is moving in say a particle accelerator, under certain circumstances, it is seen that when we see suppose the electron is impinging on a crystal, okay, and we know a crystal means they are the atoms are arranged or the molecules are arranged in a pattern, not haphazard. So they are arranged in a certain discrete pattern. So, and the gap between the molecules of a crystal, the value of that gap is of the order of the wavelength that would be associated with an electron according to de Broglie equation. The value of lambda that de Broglie gave, that value is of the same order as the gap between the interatomic distance in crystalline structures. Okay, so if you now if you switch over your thought process to a grating that we did in our physical optics classes. I did not do diffraction with you, but some teacher must have done it with you. So when you did diffraction grating, you know that a grating is a number of slits, and when light passes through it, why do we see diffraction? Why don't we see diffraction always? Suppose you have in your room, there is a window and there are these long grills in your window. Okay? Sunlight will come into your room through these grills. So why don't we see a diffraction pattern on the floor? Simply because the slit width, the gap between the grills is very, very large compared to the wavelength of the light coming in. Which is why, even if there is a diffraction pattern, the central maxima takes up the entire place. Our whatever we can see, the our the view that we get is limited to the central maxima. So even if diffraction pattern is present, because of the mismatch in the value of the wavelength of the incoming light and the gap of between the grills of your window, we cannot see any diffraction pattern. Does that mean diffraction is not taking place? Yes.
You presenting the screen, right?
You cannot see it?
No, ma'am.
No one can see the screen? But I can see the red border. Is it the problem with everybody?
Ma'am?
Yes.
One interpretation is screen ta dekhachen to.
Ha ha, right. I have not changed the slide because I am trying to give you a lot of examples. I have not changed the slide. I am on slide number 5, Born Interpretation.
Actually, the screen is absolutely black. That's all.
Then there must be some problem with your internet connection. You can log out and log in once more. Okay. I change the screen now. Can everybody see a blank screen?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. This red border, which means the presentation, the screen sharing is on. Okay, so what I'm trying to say is that when you are trying to, if you are trying to visualize this wave, then don't try to visualize this wave that is associated with the particle, moving particle, okay? Because it is not like a physical wave, it is not like a physical, water wave that we see. It is a mathematical interpretation. So when we are treating an electron which is impinging on a crystalline structure and then getting reflected, so that when we measure the intensity of the electron, how do we measure the intensity of these electrons? By measuring the current. Number of electrons flowing means the intensity will be measured by the current that is delivered by these electrons. So So when you measure the current, the results that you get do not match with a mathematical treatment that will deal with the electron as a particle. Okay, so please get this very clear in your head. When these electrons are scattered from a crystal and you measure the intensity of the current for different angles of incidence of the electron beam on the crystal, ideally you would treat the electrons as, you know, particles of a certain mass and which collides with the crystal molecules and get scattered. So it's a typical collision problem that you've done in your classical mechanics several times. But that treatment does not yield the result that you see in your experimental observation. However, if you treat the electron in such a manner that as if there is a wave associated with the electron, and instead of the electron colliding with the particle, instead of a particle-particle collision, if you think of it as a wave that is being reflected by the crystal or diffracted by the crystal, if you make your mathematical treatment in terms of a wave, then you see that the results match, the observational results match with your mathematical treatment. Okay, so remember this, that this is a mathematical interpretation. The wave is a mathematical expression of treating the electron in a different way than we know of about it classically. Okay, so now the moment it is a wave, it is a complex number. A wave is a complex number, and we sort of a complex number can be represented as a sine or a cosine function. So the moment we see it as a complex quantity, the question comes that how can a complex quantity represent a real particle? An electron is a very much real particle that has a mass, okay, and momentum and etc. So how can we represent a particle by a complex number? So which is why Born gave this interpretation. So he said that no, the wave, yes, the wave is representing the particle, but the physical interpretation of this expression is that mod chi squared, if you take the wave function and take its modulus and get the square of the modulus, then that quantity is giving us the probability of finding the particle within a certain interval at that instant of time. So if you try to find the particle at, say, your timer is at say t equal to 5 seconds, then at t equal to 5 seconds, you will not find the particle at x equal to 5 centimeter or say 10 centimeters from the origin, but between some 10 centimeter and 10 plus say 0.0005 centimeters. Okay, so this delta x is very, very small, but its role is extremely important. You cannot point your finger at a single point on the axis and say the particle is here. And this is what Born interpretation is giving us. It's the probability of finding the particle within a given interval in space at a given time. Now, I want to tell you one more thing here, that every time, every semester, I say all these things, and I feel that my students are actually listening to me and understanding, or at least trying to understand. Because now for the past few semesters, I cannot see you guys. But the answers on Born interpretation that I get in the examination are atrocious. I don't know from what notes or what Google site you, not you, whoever have written those, but please, if you don't understand, I will repeat 100 times, but you must be at a position, even if you are googling your answers, I'm not saying that you have to write from my slides. No, I'm not saying that absolutely. These slides are more for my help than for your. I hope they help you too. But these are more for my help because I don't know how to teach in an online mode without these slides. I don't feel comfortable in sharing handwritten notes and you know reading out or something like that. Not belittling any other teacher who does that, but it's just my shortcoming that I cannot teach in an online mode without the help of these slides. So I'm not saying that you have to write from here, but you must be at least as a position when you are Googling your answer out, you at least can make out between what is correct and what is incorrect. Google does not give all correct answers, please, okay? So if you are getting an answer from the internet, then at least be able to judge whether a particular answer is correct or not. I get all kinds of atrocious answers regarding Bond interpretation. It is very, very simple. Bond interpretation is that mod chi square gives the probability of finding the particle within a certain interval of space at a given time. It's plain and simple. You don't need to write anything else. You open any book of quantum mechanics, whatever is given as Bond interpretation is close to this. Will be maybe in a different language, but the main aim is this, okay? You don't need to write this whole thing. This is exactly what Bond's paper contained. And so I've given it within quotes. You don't need to write this. This is enough, but you need to understand what it says. And if you understand it, then you will be at a position to differentiate between wrong and right answers. Okay. So, as I told you, these have been discussed. Major switch over, Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. So these have been out. And now we can write the particle parameters, that is momentum and energy, in terms of wave parameters. Okay. So in the wave function, we can replace the wave number k and the frequency omega, because wave number and frequency are more related to a pure wave, if you may call it that. But if we are trying to talk about a particle and represent the wave that is associated with the particle, then we would rather talk about particle parameters than wave parameters. And in that case, we will be more comfortable if the wave function contains particle parameters like momentum and energy. So what do? We use Planck's hypothesis and de Broglie's hypothesis to write momentum and energy in terms of k and omega and use that. So this is the wave function. And using our previous slides relations, we have written the wave function in terms of momentum and energy. All this we discussed in our last class, so just recapitulation. And as this is what we said in the beginning of the class, that this is a complex function, and interpretation of how such a complex function might represent a particle, which is very much a real physical object, and that comes from the probabilistic view of quantum mechanics. So, and this is the wave function in 3D. So, you know, the entire aim of a part of quantum mechanics is this interpretation of, so you solve Schrodinger equation, you get a certain wave function as a solution of this Schrodinger equation, and then your work is to see that this particular wave function goes by the norms given by Bond. That when you get this wave function, when you take the mod square of that wave function, it should be a real number, so that represents the particle, the probability of getting the particle within a certain space interval. Okay, so that is one of the major lookouts when we solve problems. So then we derived how to find out the one-dimensional wave equation. I repeat it because I did it in quite detail, how we get to the one-dimensional wave equation. And this is our Schrodinger equation. Okay. I hope that you have gone through this slide, because I had shared it with you right after our class last week. Very simple mathematical steps, but nevertheless very important, because this is important not only from a theoretical point of view but also from the exam point of view, because several times in your examination this question comes, that set up Schrödinger equation for the one dimensional Schrödinger equation for a certain function. Okay, so this is a very important part, important easy but important derivation from exam point of view. Okay, so starting from the, so you have to remember that you have to start from the total energy expression. Okay, and just multiply it with psi on both sides, then derive it with respect to, partially with respect to x twice, so that you get px square, an expression for px square, and then you derive it, that same function psi, you derive it partially with respect to t once, so that you get something related to e, and then you put those expressions in the total energy expression multiplied with psi, and that gives you the Schrödinger equation. The equation that it gives you is basically the Schrödinger equation. Now this is not how Schrödinger derived his equation. In fact, he started from the problem that we are going to do last. We are going to do the hydrogen atom problem last, not even in this semester. But Schrödinger started his work with the hydrogen atom problem and established his equation. Okay, it's one of the most difficult but obviously most important problem, because that the hydrogen atom problem and solution leads to the entire realm of atomic and molecular physics. The entire realm of atomic and molecular physics is based on the basic solution of hydrogen atom problem, the interpretation of the hydrogen atom problem. So that was Schrödinger's first work. Okay. So then we discussed the Schrödinger equation and how to solve it. Remember, it's a partial differential equation in one dimension for the time being. So we separate, we follow the method of separation of variables. Time dependent Schrödinger equation is this: for a free particle v equal to 0, whereas if so this is the time dependent part, and if you equate it to 0, if the differential with respect to t is not there, then we get the time independent part. So we can separate the Schrödinger equation into the time dependent and time independent functions, so that the function psi is actually the product of the time dependent and time independent part, capital X and capital T I took. And for three dimensions, you simply replace the X, the function of X, by a function of X, Y and Z, which we call capital R of small r, okay, where small r is the position vector. So in our Schrödinger equation, if we write psi as the product of the time dependent and time independent functions, then this is what we get. And again, I have shown you the steps for the one dimensional case. This is what we get. So we can see that the left hand side depends on space only. This is the time independent part. The right hand side depends on time only. So this is the time dependent part. And therefore, we can equate each side to a certain constant, and obviously since we started off from the expression of total energy and we know that total energy is a constant for a mechanical system, so this constant will obviously be the total energy. So we equate the time dependent part with E and get an expression of T, which is an exponential function in T minus T. Okay, so this is the time dependent solution of Schrödinger equation in 1D as well as 3D, because you can understand that if you switch over to 3D, the time dependent part will not change. The time independent part, as I remember telling you, will depend, the solution of the time independent part will depend totally on the nature of V. So whichever force the particle is moving under the effect of, that will give us a certain potential, and depending on the potential we will get the solution of the time independent part accordingly. Okay, so this is the 1D time independent Schrodinger equation, and as I told you, and okay, these are called steady state wave functions because these are independent of time, so the solutions of the time independent Schrodinger equation are also called steady state wave functions. This part also. And finally, since this is a particular solution, we can write down the general solution as the summation. So the final expression of the solution of the one-dimensional Schrodinger equation is this. Okay. Summation CnxnX e to the power minus I En h cut t. So when you are working out for a single energy, we get only one state, but in general there can be several energies corresponding to the different states, and so we must superpose all these states to get the general solution, and the general solution looks like this. Okay, all right. Now we move on to the three-dimensional wave equation. So in the three-dimensional wave equation, we can write the momentum p squared, no longer px squared but p squared, which means the dot product of p with itself, p dot p, which is px squared plus py squared plus pz squared. So in the total energy expression, we have E psi equal to 1 by 2m px squared plus py squared plus pz squared into psi plus V shall as it is. Okay, and the expression of the wave function is psi equal to a to the power I by h cut pxx, because we had just pxx there, here we have p dot r, so we have pxx plus pyy plus pzz minus et. Okay, so basically del psi del x, if you differentiate with respect to x only, then del 2 psi del x 2 will give you minus h cut square del 2 psi del x 2. Similarly, p y square psi will be minus h cut square del 2 psi del y 2, and p z square psi will be minus h cut square del 2 psi del z. Also, we already have e psi equal to I h cut del psi del t, so that these two together in this particular equation, if you club them together, px square plus py square plus pz square is actually h cut square by 2m, and inside bracket you will have del 2 psi del x square plus del 2 psi del y square plus del 2 psi del z square, which you know is the expression of the Laplacian. So instead of the single variable second order derivative, we have the Laplacian in the three dimensional wave. So the three-dimensional wave equation or Schrodinger equation in three dimensions is minus h cut square by 2m del 2 psi plus v psi equal to I h cut del psi del t. The equation in 3D. Now we can look for a solution of the three-dimensional wave equation, but here again we will follow the separation of variables rule, and in the 3D wave equation, right, psi as the product of r and t, so that this is what we get, h cut square by 2m t outside, and inside bracket we have del 2r del x2 plus del 2r del y2 plus del 2r del z2 plus v into r t equal to I h cut r dt dt ddt of capital T. Why d and not del? Because capital T is a function of small t only, so we need not write del over here, but r is a function of x, y and z, so therefore here we have to maintain writing the partial derivatives. So these are small things that you need to keep in mind. Now again, I h cut by t ddt of capital T equal to e is the time independent part, and as I told you, there will be no change in the solution for t because it does not change its form whether it is in 3D or 1D. So the time dependent function remains capital T equal to C to the power minus I by H part capital E into T. The time independent part now can be written as del 2r plus 2m by h cut square e minus b into r equal to 0. So once again you can see that the solution will depend totally on the nature of v, the potential. Okay, so in 3D the time dependent waveform is r into t. So c r, the form that you will get once you know the form of v, multiplied by e to the power minus I e by h cut. So now that we know mathematically what the solution looks like, we know the general form of the solution with only the unknown function of the space part. The space part, the time independent part of the Schrödinger equation solution remains unknown until we know the form of the potential. So the form of the potential will decide the form of that function. But otherwise we are sort of not familiar, but we at least know what the solution looks like. But now we have to look for a physical interpretation of the wave function. Okay, so as I told you that there is a lot of mathematics in quantum mechanics. You will see that at one point of time you are doing pages after pages of derivation and you would feel a little bit disillusioned about the fantasy that quantum mechanics is. Am I doing a mathematics honors course or a physics honors course? Because I'm going on doing partial differential equations and solving them. But at the end, as I keep telling you, that is only the tool. Your final focus should be on physically interpreting the result. It is not sufficient just to get the result. You must also know what is the physical interpretation of the result. Okay, that is where physics plays the role. So what is the physical interpretation of the wave function? The solution of Schrödinger equation, as we have all seen, is a complex function. So as I was telling you in the beginning of this class, that we should not attempt to give the wave functions a physical existence that is measurable by actual instruments. You know what I told you, how I misinterpreted the visualization when I was a student. Frankly, I totally used to think that there is a wave that is moving along with the particle. You know, I mean, I can still sit and visualize what I used to think about it when I was sitting in my college listening to quantum mechanics lectures. It was totally my mistake, but because since I made that mistake, I try to tell my students not to make that mistake. Okay. So it is best not to attempt to give it a physical picture that can be measured by an instrument, like, you know, water waves and all. So what do we measure then? When a moving particle is behaving like a wave and we are getting results that show us the wave behavior, that tell us that until we make the mathematical treatment in terms of a wave, we will not get the result compatible with the experimental observation. So then what do we measure? If we cannot measure the wave, you know, we cannot think of physical existence of the wave, then what do we measure, comes the question. So there comes in the discussion that we had in the beginning of the class, and Krishnendu pointed out that complex function is any sort of complex function can be finally written in this form, psi equal to a plus ib. Okay, so psi star is a minus ib, right? So we define the quantity p, which is a function of x, y, z and t, as psi star psi, the modulus of the complex function, the mod square. And no matter what kind of a complex function psi is, the mod squared will always be equal to a squared plus b squared. because any kind of a complex function can be written as a plus ib, so that its complex conjugate can be written as a minus ib, and therefore the modulus square of this function will always be equal to a square plus b square, which is a real number and therefore can be measured. All right, so Krishnendu, I hope I've answered your question. So this is why this interpretation is so important, because an abstract idea is well and good, but when we are doing a fundamental science, we need something that is measurable. Okay, a wave is associated with a particle that does not have a real physical existence, but then how do we measure things? So this is what we do. We interpret, we define a certain quantity, which is basically the mod square of that complex function. And since it is the mod square, it is a real number, and therefore it is a measurable quantity. Get it bored into your heads. P x y z t equal to psi star psi equal to mod psi square is called the probability density. The probability density. So whatever complex problem we are attacking using Schrodinger equation, when we finally get the solution, just the solution is of no use to us. We have to finally get the probability density. We have to get the solution, and then we have to get mod psi square. We have to go get to the probability density. This is our final destination. Okay? Probability density. P equal to mod psi square. Loud and clear? Okay? So this is what was defined by Born. So we have been talking about Max Born's interpretation so long. Basically, this is the mathematical quantity that Born defined. So we were talking just about mod psi square. So basically, Born gave it that mod psi square in analogy with capital E square of electromagnetic waves. In analogy with that, Born defined it, and he also named a function for this quantity mod psi square, and this name, the coining of P equal to mod psi square, was done by Born as probability density. Okay? So obviously in one dimension, P, capital P xt is psi star psi, psi x star xt into psi xt. And what is the meaning of Px dx? Now, once again, please be very careful. If you're asked to write down the definition of probability density, then probability density is mod psi squared, the mathematical quantity. Okay? But Pxt dx is the probability of finding the particle at a coordinate between x and x plus dx. Very, very subtle difference, but very, very important. Just the function is mod psi squared, and it is called the probability density. Okay? But the function multiplied by dx, Pxt dx, is the probability of finding the particle at a coordinate between x and x plus dx. Is this clear to everybody? And this is Born interpretation. So we talked a lot about Born interpretation in a previous slide, but that was all language. But we understand mathematics better. So this slide actually tells you what Born interpretation is. Is this clear? Please see and try to understand whether you have understood. If not, then I'll explain. I'll go through it, repeat it once more.
Ma'am.
Yes.
Can we say mathematically that if we, I'm not sure about this, that if we select the limits, the upper and the lower limits as minus infinity to plus infinity, then will the value always be 1?
Yes, of course, we will be coming to that. That is another very, very important point. And we will be coming to that. I think in the very next slide, we'll come to that. And that is very, very important too. Actually, those are the conditions that are necessary for a wave, for a function to be called a solution of Schrödinger equation. So the moment you solve a particular problem using Schrödinger equation and get the solution psi, your first job will be to see whether it is representable as mod psi square equal to a real number. Okay, this is one of the conditions for a function to be called a solution of Schrödinger equation, that it satisfies, it is in accordance with Born interpretation. Okay? So please, whichever book you are looking at, whatever Google site you are looking at, please don't forget these two things. First, just the function Pxt equal to mod psi square, that is probability density. When you multiply Pxt with dx, Pxt dx, that is the probability of finding a particle between x and x plus dx at a certain time. I hope I'm clear by now. Okay, so what do we measure? We measure this thing, Pxt dx. The probability of finding the particle between x and x plus dx at any instant of time. Okay. So now we will do a thought experiment. Okay. What thought experiment? Consider identical systems. We consider a number of systems, all of which can be represented by this function psi of x. So they are identical systems, a set of electrons, all of them represented by this function psi x. Okay. Now let us consider measuring this quantity Pxt dx repeatedly on these systems at the same instant of time t. So at a particular instant of time t, you are measuring Pxt for all the systems. Say suppose there are n systems. So at a particular interval of time, instant of time t, you are trying to measure the probability of, not probability density, but Pxt dx for all these systems that are identical and represented by the function psi xt. And then take the average over all these measured values. So you have got a set of measurements, measured values for all the systems. Take an average of that. So the result that you get is defined as the expectation value. Again, a very, very, very important term that will keep repeating itself in all problems. In fact, we will have to find, this will be our job. Once we do a problem, we will have to find the expectation value. So once again, what is expectation value? Once I give you the mathematical expression, it will be a little more clear. So what are we doing? We consider, say, n systems, identical systems, all represented by the same wave function, psi xt. Now for all these systems, we measure Pxt dx at a certain interval of time. So we get n sets of values, n results. We take an average of all these results. So we finally have one particular value, the mean value. that result is called the expectation value. Now, what is the physical interpretation of this? So mathematically, the expectation value is written in this way. If you have two angular brackets and the parameter is within the two angular brackets, a pair of angular brackets, then, so suppose we are trying to measure the expectation value of the quantity x. All right. So what is, how do we define it? Integration minus infinity to plus infinity x px dt. Dx, sorry, not dt, dx. All right. Now, what is pxt? Pxt is psi star xt into psi xt. So basically, expectation value of x is equal to integration minus infinity to plus infinity psi star xt x psi xt dx. So what do? We write this, the parameter for which you are trying to find the expectation value is written sandwiched between the complex conjugate and the normal wave function. This is the way we write the expectation value mathematically. So in general, for any function of x, fx can be any function of x, the expectation value is mathematically written like this. Expectation value fx equal to minus infinity to plus infinity psi star xt fx into psi xt into dx. Once again, go through the slide and see if you understood. Okay. So the expectation value for position of a given wave function is this expectation value x, is this psi star x psi dx integrated from minus infinity to plus infinity. Similarly, you can find the expectation value of the potential for a given wave function. Expectation value v equal to minus infinity to plus infinity psi star v psi dx. So once you know psi, you can find the expectation value of any physical parameter related to that wave function. This is almost like, you know, finding the mean of a certain quantity in an experiment. Expectation value of linear momentum, psi star p psi, integration minus infinity to plus, and there will be a dx over here. Grave mistake. There will be a dx over here. Okay. Total energy. So it's the same definition, but when the parameter changes, the quantity sandwiched between the complex conjugate and the wave function within the integral, that parameter just keeps on changing. Okay. Now we must note that quantum mechanics can only provide predictions. It's a predicting science. You cannot say that this will happen. You can say this may happen. Now the chance is very high, obviously, because you know, the universe is resting on quantum mechanics. So obviously the chances that are predicted by quantum mechanics are extremely fair chances, but at the same time you must not forget that it is a predictive evaluation. It cannot tell us that a particle in a given energy state will be found at a precise location at a certain time. It will not be able to tell us the precise location. Again, it will give us the probability. Okay? It may only give us relative probabilities that the particle will be found at various locations at that time, between x and x plus dx. Okay? The predictions of quantum mechanics are statistical in nature. This you will understand what we are basically talking about when we do the statistical interpretation of several things that we're doing now when we do them again in SEM 5. Quantum mechanics expresses itself as probabilities and not certainties. This is something that you must keep in mind always, that all results of quantum mechanics are probabilistic. There is no certainty. Causality relation is of course followed. That is never violated, but it is, the results are always probabilistic. Okay. End today. I will not start with operators. We'll do operators in our next class. Not many new slides were discussed today, but the few that were discussed are of extreme importance from their point of view of conceptual understanding. Okay, and it is very, very important that you go through the slides and see where your doubts are. If you say in the next class that no, ma'am, no doubts, everything understood, then no, that cannot happen. Even after teaching quantum mechanics for the last, I think, 10 years, I still have doubts. Every time I prepare a lecture, I have my doubts. I go through some books. I try to clear my doubts. I try to see whether what I will be telling will be convincing enough. Okay. So it cannot be that you don't have any doubts in quantum mechanics. So please, my request and advice, whatever you call it, however you see it, will be that please go through the slides, go through whatever book you have and see which are the portions, try to point out which are the portions that you have not understood, that are blurry, you know, that are not clear. And don't hesitate to ask me.